Welcome to Rock You Like a Hurricane Rana. My name's Simon Tackler, my co-host, Owen Jones. Owen, hello.
Hello, how are we?
Oh, very good. This is a massive episode. It's one we've planned for months.
I think I've had it written since May.
You wrote this. That's how professional this episode is going to be.
Yeah, we're not fucking around.
Not at all. So thanks for listening. Make sure you share and subscribe and tell your friends and rate it. We've got to get all that stuff out of the way. So, this episode is all about Kiss.
Yes.
You wanted the best. You've got the best. The hottest band in the world, Kiss. And to help us on this journey is the biggest Kiss fan we know.
Yes.
It's none other than Julian James. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you, Simon. Thank you, Ozone. Great to be back here.
Oh, it's a pleasure. How are we? You good?
I'm good. Oh, that's what I was just saying. Felt like we just did this a couple of weeks
ago. Yes. Yeah. And we are recording this the morning of Ace Frehley and Gene Simmons in Melbourne, so Jules is ready to go.
Kiss fever.
He's in a Kiss mood. Yeah. That's probably why you're a little bit sick. You got the fever.
I know. I've got the Kiss fever. And you know what? We need to call out the Doctor of Love. All right, that's my dad.
We're good. We're done. No, that's the show. Done.
Yes, we're done. We'll insert the audio of the song and it just wraps up.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so we are basically going to run through.
It's like our old Super Show kind of formats we've done in the past. We just pick a band, run through them, and talk about how they ruined wrestling.
Well, yeah, there's no better band to do that than Kiss.
Yeah, there will be a little bit of wrestling talk in this episode. So, Owen, where do we start with Kiss?
I guess we start at the start. Kiss were formed in 1973 in New York City by Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley after they abandoned their previous rock and roll group, Wicked Lester.
Now, have we heard that album?
I've heard bits and pieces, but I haven't heard it all.
Yeah, I didn't mind it. I got it when I was in my teens. Someone did a copy on cassette for me and it was a bit weird, but I enjoyed, you know, you could really hear the genesis of what was to come.
It was very like sweet and like and Slade influenced, wasn't
it? I thought it was even more leaning towards like a Jethro Tull thing. Like I think from, I haven't heard it in years, but from memory, I think there was even a flute solo in She, because they did She on it, and but other bits and pieces. But it was a real interesting sort of blueprint for what was to come.
Yeah. So was that a big collector's item back in the day? Like if you had the Wicked Lester?
Oh, yeah, but more so that just getting copies of things, whereas now you can, I think you could get it pressed on vinyl and stuff like that. But as far as, because I don't think it was ever, well, I know it was never officially released. So all you were getting was third, fourth, fifth, probably 10th generation copies of it. So, but to have it, that was pretty rare at the time from the circles I was moving in.
Imagine owning that now, like the first like pressing. Like
the actual
like stumbling apart.
Or even the tapes. Like they're probably sitting in a vault somewhere. I'm surprised that the record company didn't come out and try to scooch a buck off that when they get big.
The old remastered editions of everything that go around.
Who else played on that album? Like, what happened to those guys? Wouldn't you be spewing?
Yeah, how bad? I would go into it, but it, like, you'd be pissed off, wouldn't you? Like, because Gene and, from what I know, Gene and Ace, Gene and Paul were just like, I'll start something else.
Yeah.
So, like, they've left the two other guys in the lurch.
I did read an interview with one of them years ago, and he didn't seem bitter about it. He sort of understood that we realized we didn't fit with what they wanted to do.
Yeah.
But the thing that was funny in the interview is how he kept referring to Paul Stanley as Stan. It's like, I'm not buying in. I knew him when he was Stanley. I'm not going with the new gimmick.
No gimmicks. No gimmicks allowed.
Can I just say, Wicked Lester is a really cool name, though.
Oh, yeah.
It's a very cool band.
And that's the thing. It sounded a lot heavier than what the album was, because you put it on, it's going, oh, Wicked Lester, it's going to be early Kiss, and you put it on, you're like, what the hell is this?
But so then they kind of started forming Kiss to an extent. As I said, they took a lot of influence from Slade, who are one of my favorite bands who I grew up listening to, thanks to the old man. And then in February 1974, they released their first ever single, which was Strutter. Now, I've said this in a couple of our other episodes when it's more about like bands before the MTV internet era. Imagine hearing this as like the first thing you've ever listened to of Kiss. Like, brand new band comes out. It's like, it's pretty cool. And then you wait, because obviously there's no internet. You don't know what they look like.
Yeah.
And then you see a photo of them or whatever. And it's like, they're wearing all this makeup. Like, how would you feel? You're like, oh, this is so cool. And then it's like, not what you meant, like you imagine them to be.
Yeah, did you hear Kiss before seeing them, or was the image with,
I think
the sound?
because I can't remember, because I had older sisters, so it was sort of in the house, but the memory of it was more the image
yep.
rather than the songs per se. Like yep. I couldn't, besides I Was Made, I couldn't really name anything else from being a kid, but it was definitely the image that sucked me in. And I think what you just said about hearing it and then seeing it also went the other way. Like I've heard so many stories from big bands that were influenced by Kiss in the 70s saying they saw them first.
Yeah.
And then like the guys from, I think it was System of a Down,
yep.
were saying he had his walls covered in Kiss posters before he ever heard them.
yeah.
You know? Or that thing of people being thrown going, oh, it was more a polished pop rock thing rather than say a Misfits punky.
Yeah.
goth thing that I think people were more expecting from their sound.
Well, yeah. I guess like at the time there was like bands like the New York Dolls doing the more like femme glam stuff. They were the more androgynous thing, whereas these guys were going for the more shock factor.
Yeah. But musically, there is a disconnect with their image.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because I can
yeah.
imagine like in the 70s, if I heard that song, I'm just going to picture a typical
like a Slade, like a Slade or a Sweet band. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
yeah even yeah. that. You know, they've always had that sort of polished pop element to their music.
Yeah.
yeah.
And I think the image throws people off. Because I meet people now who are like, oh, Kiss, I don't really know them. And then, you know, if you play it or they hear it, you're like, this is Kiss.
Mm.
And it always...
But yeah, the sound yeah. and the image, I think they were closer to the Archies than they were to, you know, Sabbath as far yeah. as that. You know, kids could digest this. Yeah. It wasn't too big and scary.
But
yeah.
I think that's how they win, you know, so yeah. many different demographics over.
Definitely.
You know?
But, yeah, so and the thing is, like, saying, like, how bands like System of a Down were influenced more the image. Like, I feel like this is their the first album, obviously, and it's got the song Firehouse, which if you go into the, about a decade later, there was a band called Firehouse, and they were a great band, by the way. Listen to Firehouse. and they've come out, they've said that they were literally influenced by that song, and yeah. they call themselves Firehouse because of that song, so... There you go. And that's the thing. They got Strutter and Deuce on that album and still two of their biggest songs.
Yeah.
And that album was now, what, 44 years old?
Yeah. So. I think Deuce is one of their best songs.
Yeah.
If I was putting a top 10, that'd be in there.
Yeah, and still a standard opener.
Yeah. From and all accounts. Melbourne Pro Wrestler Cletus uses it as his entrance song for those playing at home.
There you go. And no one still has any idea what the song means.
exactly. Like what?
He's worth a deuce.
What does it even mean? I have no idea.
Does she mean she's going to lay a deuce on him? I don't know. Am I going to a darker place than what it's intended?
I always thought it does sort of mean that, surely. Like he's worth a shit. Like, you know, it's... You know, worth giving a shit about?
Maybe. Obviously, he's not worth shit at all.
Yeah. Oh,
well, there you go. Shit.
There you go.
It is that.
Oh, look at us. Just...
We're cracking open the yeah. secrets of the Kiss universe.
We're cracking open the deuce.
Yeah.
but, so, and just quickly, the album's cover is a homage to the Beatles record with the Beatles. Like, the members' faces laid out very similar to the way that album's laid out.
Which also always made me think about Van Halen's OU812. I
yeah,
felt that had the same
it's
thing.
It's the exact same thing. Yeah. They're the two records, like that's how they've done it as well. So
yeah.
Also underrated Van Halen album. That's a different that's another episode to go into.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think Kiss doing that, like it's a cool idea of saying like this is what rock music is now, you know, they're all in the makeup, like to really get away from the image of what the Beatles would have been.
And speaking of the makeup, we have to address Peter Criss's horrible makeup job on the front cover.
Yes,
the
I have read about that.
Detailed one.
And yeah, and then they kind of like notch it back after that.
Yeah, I think that was the first time someone else had done the makeup. And there's, you can see there's some tiki doll or something that it was based on.
Yep.
But yeah, definitely over detailed.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
You can't see Peter Criss after a few, you know, getting ready for his show and having whatever he took, thinking now I've got to get all these little whiskers right.
I'm impressed that they do it themselves. It's like wrestlers who paint their faces too.
Yeah.
It's very impressive.
It's very impressive.
I couldn't do it.
But yeah, you look at the album cover, he's got like the black eyes and the red lips, but then he goes to the green eyes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
But that all that stuff I thought was interesting, how over time they all that those things to accentuate, you know, with the colours and just how perfect it always was. As you said, them doing it themselves, there was never any time where you sort of went, oh, what happened that night? Or remember that night he had it smeared at... You know, it would have been a very cathartic thing to have to zone in and get all those lines right and straight and making it look perfect every night.
So as a kid, who stood out to you the most face paint?
Oh, I was a Jean guy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Absolutely,
was
a Jean guy.
Was that your dress-up party costume of choice?
Oh, yeah. Just get my hairy chest out as a 7-year-old and try to bed some women.
Thousands of women, if you believe him. But yeah, and then, Jesus, and then about 8 months later, in 1974, Kiss released their second album in October 1974, which is the first. We'll go into it, but they released a couple of years later, they released two albums in the same year as well. It was more the thing in the 70s.
ACDC did, you know, similar things too. You would just pump out music back then.
Beatles did it as well.
And then I think we'll get there for 1978, if you count the solo albums, Alive 2 and Double Platinum. That's six releases in the space of a year.
Yep.
That's crazy.
Opening song on Hotter... The album was Hotter Than Hell. Opening song was Got to Choose, probably one of my favourite Kiss songs. But the rest of the album didn't really do as too well critically.
Yeah, that and people still talk about the production and the sound of this album.
It's very tinny.
It's tinny, it's compressed. I don't know what they were thinking. They must have been on some hard stuff, the guys who were recording it, because it's definitely... I don't know... It's a weird one. You can't even tell what they were going for unless, you know, Metallica took a bit of influence with the Sanger.
Well, you look at it this way, like, their first album was huge, like, a couple months prior. So I guess they were kind of going, hey, let's just, like, go in, write some songs and release them and, like, just do it, like, get in it while we're hot and try and capitalize on that.
And that old saying of, you know, you've got the lifetime to write the first album and 6 months to write the second one.
Yeah. So, yeah, there's not a whole lot about this album that kind of stands out apart from the opening song.
Yeah,
so.
And the artwork, though.
The artwork's pretty cool.
I think it's a good, like, you know, it's a good cover.
I remember seeing that cover when I was younger thinking, because I'd buy the Kiss records secondhand from a place in Surfers Paradise called the Record Exchange.
Okay.
So once a week or whenever I had the pocket money going, and so I'd pick one out, just picking them from which covers I thought were cool. And I always thought the Hotter Than Hell one looked the most dangerous. It was like, oh, I'm not sure about this one. I'm not ready for this one yet.
That's like it's got them in the front. It's like in the, it's a black and white photo of them, which I think is amazing. And it's like this big like gradient of color in the background.
Yeah,
I love it.
And Paul gripping Peter's thigh, I think it was. It was always a bit, I don't know if I'm ready for that either.
It's beautiful. It's very beautiful. So moving on, we get
Dressed to Kill's next.
Yes, absolutely it is.
Now that's a great album
awesome
cover.
Album. That's an iconic album cover, that one.
Yeah. And that's probably in my top five Kiss albums.
Really?
This one, yeah.
It's really funny because like non-Kiss fans would look at that the tracks on that album going, I literally know one song, and it's the last song on the album, which is Rock and Roll All Night.
Yeah.
But then you listen to the album in full, it's a fucking good album.
Yeah, I just thought it was just classic rock and roll, you know, as far as a 70s album goes, I just think it's all winner.
Absolutely. So yeah, this was released in 1975, and although the album has, as I said, fantastic album artwork, they wore like the three-piece suits, that look very mobbish. I like how Jean's the only one wearing a coloured suit as well.
Yeah.
All the other
the
three
clogs
wearing,
on.
Yeah, it's so beautiful.
Fitting. I think someone's wearing a suit that Bill Orcoin, the manager, that belonged to him.
Amazing. This is why we have Jules on. He knows all these little tidbits.
I'm a fountain of useless information. I'm glad it could be put to use today.
As my dad says, trivia is bullshit and I'm full of trivia. So then we get... Yeah, it's got Rock and Roll All Night, which is obviously the career-defining song. But due to the short length of the album, a touch under half an hour, the original vinyl versions had long pauses between each track to create an illusion that both sides were longer than they actually were.
I love that. It's so funny.
Yeah. So if you look at the vinyl, there's like that smooth bit. It's like a little bit longer, so it's like to make you feel like you're listening to like a longer album. Because like it'd be 15 minutes each side.
Yeah.
Not even.
Yeah, that's crazy. So, I remember when we did the Thunderstag CD years ago, and I think that clocked in just at like 30 minutes or just under, and we're like, are we sure we can call this an album? And I was like, hey, if they could do it with Dressed to Kill, then we could do it.
Exactly.
Put awkward pauses at the end of each song?
I wish I'd heard of that. Yeah, 3 minute pauses in between or some infomercials in between.
I like that because the funny trick, like when you had that in the notes, I thought that's almost a trick like I have to use at work sometimes. If I need to like time an ad like on the radio or whatever, I'll just do like awkward pauses in between words, and I'm like, oh, okay.
Well, Adam West used it in the old Batman to keep the camera on him longer instead of saying, we've got to catch the Riddler, we've got to catch the Riddler. And as he spoke in that thing to keep more camera time on him.
It's beautiful. It's such a Kanye
move. So they Adam Wested the album.
There you go.
Stretch it out.
Don't rush it.
Don't rush it. Adam Wested.
Yeah.
We have to touch on this. Like, it's the Kiss song. I feel like it's the first Kiss song everyone. I guess more my generation is definitely...
Yeah, they still play it on the radio.
They still play it. But see, now that I've seen the movie, every time I hear this song, this reminds me of Kiss in the Phantom of the Park.
Right.
The shittest, great, the best, worst movie I've ever seen.
I still haven't seen it.
Oh, it's so beautifully bad. You're missing out.
Okay.
Then it was the live version that I think more got played in the States that broke for them with this. But no, this is classic. And I think it still sounds great today. Like, to put it on now, like, from what you had that Hotter Than Hell recording before it, that sounded like it was recorded in a shed to this.
The production on this album is really good.
I think it still stands up.
Absolutely. It's one of those songs that will get non-rock fans or non-Kiss fans. You know, it is there.
And speaking of Slade, it's that simple Slade formula.
Yeah, man.
Here's a chorus and here it is again and here it is again. And
we'll do 8-bar verse, chorus, chorus, verse, bridge, chorus for the rest of the song.
Then chorus you to death.
Yeah. It's the old classic 70s rock style of writing songs, but we don't hate it.
I loved when they used this in the Scooby-Doo movie, because it's just, I could so see this as like being used in a cartoon thing.
You said Scooby-Doo, and as I said, Kiss and the Phantom of the Park, that was produced by Hanna and Barbera. Yeah, it was. Hence why it's so hokey and so beautifully bad.
Yeah.
I'm not bagging it. I actually love it. It's because it's so bad. But later in 1975, Kiss Alive was released, which I guess is one of the albums where people think of.
It for him. It sort of breaks him.
Yeah, they call it the gateway. As Kiss being a gateway band for a lot of bands that got into Kiss, then they discovered these other bands. This, I think, was the album that kicked that door open.
Yeah, many say it was one of the best and most influential live albums of all time. It was recorded over a space of 4 concerts in 1975, but not in a row. It was like 4 different in like over a couple months.
And then we found out later, most of it was recorded in the studio.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, I wasn't a huge mark for this album, funnily enough. I think it was because I remember the first time I heard it, a kid I went to school with, he had it at his house. His dad had it and played it on a cassette on some little,
shitty little radio.
And it doesn't do it justice to hear it like that. You need it on the big speakers. It just sounded too, it sounded messy to me the first time I heard it.
That's the thing. I feel like that's the thing with especially like the old 70s rock, and speaking from experience, because that's like on the weekends when I was a kid, it was... Mum and Dad put vinyl on the big Marantz system in the front room.
Right.
And like, especially with stuff like, Slade, Jethro Tull, Sweet, what Dad listened to, I'm like, this is cool. Yeah. Like, you got this big fucking booming sound coming out of this massive stereo.
And especially to have this on vinyl with that gatefold and you could read those notes they had. And, I'm looking at it on some cassette and hearing it through tinny speakers. But once I got the vinyl, and then I was like, okay, now I get it. And that picture on the back of the fans holding that sign up. And from what I heard, that wasn't even taken at a Kiss concert. Like, it was taken as a Deep Purple or something. Amazing. These are the rumors. I don't know. There'll be Kiss fans out there. There was a Kiss concert.
But that's why this album is so good, because it's like the idea of going to a live show. You know, it's the essence of it.
It didn't bother
energy.
Me at all to hear that it wasn't done live. I was like, it didn't bother me.
Well, digging into my fandom, Van Halen did the same thing with Live Right Here Right Now in 91. That was it was recorded live, but then they went back in the studio and dubbed most of it.
Yeah,
and
what Sammy wasn't happy
Sammy
about.
Sammy hated
to go
that
back
one.
And do it because either this was out of tune or this was out of time.
Eddie and Alex like, we need to change this and this. And Sammy's like, I just want to release it.
I do like that Sammy said he just did it all in one take because it was live.
Yeah.
He was watching the screen and did his thing and he was like, I'm out of here.
That's why I'm a Sammy Mark more than DLR.
He had to get back to the beach because there were tequila shots that needed to be done.
But this album, so Kiss Alive went to number 18 in Australia,
right?
Which is pretty cool. I guess for a live album back then, it wasn't really a known format of album.
Yeah.
So I guess people were taking a punt on it.
And this is what wins people over, I guess, in terms of, you hear it, and I can understand it. If you heard this, you're looking at the pictures, this is a band I have to see.
Oh, yeah.
Ace just shredding the shit out of that guitar, by the way.
This version of Juice is even better.
I think it's the best one.
You know. Yeah, they're on fire there.
Absolutely. So yeah, between I guess now it's the big one, 1976. We get into the Kiss album, I guess, as everyone would put it. It's Destroyer. Released in 1976, quite possibly the most iconic and well-known Kiss album of all time.
Again, great artwork.
Yeah, I was about to say the fantasy artwork cover.
Yep.
You're hooked in. And that intro, all this for Detroit Rock City, the theatre of the mind that so they captured good. Here.
There we go.
What a song to open an album.
So I say this to a lot of people, like friends in bands especially. I guess I have that older mentality because of the music I listen to. Because like, we can kind of like, if we write like 11 songs for an album, it doesn't really matter what song we open. I'm like, yes, it does.
Yeah.
Like if your first song on the album doesn't capture me, I'm not going to listen to the rest of the album.
Yeah.
And that's especially with this song. It gives you that minute and a half intro, like, oh, what's going to happen? Yep. And you listen to it, like, oh, shit, that's kind of cool with like the rumbling bass at the start.
Oh, yeah.
Band builds up and it kicks you straight in the dick.
And I think this also set the tone of the album. Like, how are they going to top this for the rest of the album? That's why they go to all these wild places and, you know, with the orchestras and all that.
And then later in the album, they have Beth, which is...
What a wild card.
It is a wild card, but it was their biggest song until they released Forever, which is Simon's favourite Kiss song. We'll get into that later. as I said, it's got Detroit Rock City, God of Thunder, Shout Out Loud, Beth featuring piano. So yeah, Bob Ezrin, the producer of the album, played piano on that song.
And this is where I think they started doing the sub-ins where Ace didn't play on some tracks that it came out later.
And Peter Chris wrote Beth, didn't he? Did he sing it? Or did he...
He wrote it, I think, with the Stan Pentridge.
Yeah.
Was his, they'd kicked it around in the former band of theirs and had brought it in, and then it got reworked, and Bob Ezrin did his magic to it and brought the orchestra in. And you've got to hand it to Kiss, too, that this is a huge gamble after you've done this Kiss Alive thing.
Yep.
And kick some doors open, and then you could have gone, all right, let's go back to our basic rock and roll, but to do something like this. But then I guess you had the things of Alice Cooper's Welcome to My Nightmare.
Because that was around the same time, wasn't it?
So it was it was Bob Ezrin as well.
And that was a concept album.
The concept album and doing that, you know, throwing the orchestra behind the bands at the time and taking that gamble. But these songs, every song on it's killer, I think.
Yeah, and again, that Alice Cooper album's got that's, again, iconic painted artwork.
Yeah,
like him as the magician coming out of that little triangle in the front cover of the album.
Oh, it's great.
Love it. Again, that was the thing. Painted artwork back then just looks so much better.
Yeah.
Mm.
Like hand painted.
The extra effort.
And it's stuff you still see on t-shirts and stuff today.
Exactly. I've seen people I saw this guy come into my work the other month with that tattooed on his arm. I'm like,
nice.
That's sick. Wow.
Now, is this where like the merch part of Kiss really kicks in after Kiss Alive, I guess?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think this is where they sort of said, oh, we're onto something here and...
We can sell anything.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Boy, and they opened a can of worms with that one.
I love that solo too. It's so simple, but it, you know, everyone knows
it's
it.
Like, it's like the four-part, the four-part quadruple, like dubbed harmonies. So they sound really sick as well.
And I remember listening to this when I was younger and thinking, am I hearing keys there, padding out the guitar? And that's when I thought, oh, that was brilliant. We did that on a lot of the Shine CDs. We just have keyboards padding out the guitars in the background just to give it a bigger, thicker sound.
Very good. I like it. You can say they peaked at this album. Well, some would say they peaked this album. I'm probably going to get heaps of hate for saying that. But, and then they release, they just keep releasing albums. In 1977, they released
Love. Also, can I just say, the end of that song with the car crash sound.
Amazing.
It is amazing, but when you, hear that the song is based on a true story, kind of tasteless.
It's a little bit.
And I'm sure everyone's had that incident of listening to it cranked in the car for the first time and thinking, what the hell?
and then later in 1976, Kiss released Rock and Roll Over, which I guess isn't one of their biggest albums.
Well, yeah, I think this was the back to the basics rock album that they could have gone with after Alive. But I think, and once again, I think sonically this is one of their better sounding albums. It was recorded in a theatre.
Was it?
Yeah. So that's Peter Chris was sort of secluded in one area and had a camera on him, and the control room was in another area of the theatre. You know, I can just hear the production coming miles ahead.
Yeah. With each album. I guess with the drum sound, it sounds a little bit boomier, a little bit more like resonant.
And I mean, they could have gone back and done another album with Bob Ezrin straight away. So I'm surprised they didn't do that. So
yeah.
I really respect the fact they went, no, now it's time just for get back to meat and potatoes, rock and roll.
Absolutely. And then the next year, they just keep churning out the albums and they release, again, one of their bigger albums, again, with sick album art, Love Gun.
Yeah, I think this is where I would think that they started to peak with the merchandise and all that, because this is when you had the movie and the dolls. Everything was sort of based on this era with the costumes and stuff.
Yeah. Now, do you have original Run Kiss dolls? Or yes. Do you actually?
Yeah. I had the Gene when I was little and I'd lost it. And then years later, like in must have been like the late 80s when I started getting into Kiss again, and I remember putting an ad in the Trading Post for like wanting Kiss stuff, and some girl rung and said, oh, I'm a doll collector and I've got these Kiss dolls that are just horrific, do you want to come and get them? And I was like, yeah, all right. And she was like, $20 each, and I said, yeah, fine.
Are they like a good
yeah they were perfect
do you
like,
still just, have them
yeah still wow. got them, they're in the glass cabinet,
so. That is
yeah, it was quite a fun. They still had like the little armbands on. So, and her name was Dolly, which is, I don't know if that was a work or not. Yeah. But no, I've still got those.
Yeah, like you look online, sometimes it pops up on like the Facebook marketplace or whatever, or you go to like collectibles places and like $300-$400 for not the set, just for one of them.
Yeah, and if they're in the box, I saw they've also, how they did the reissue of them a few years ago. And they've reissued them again now, but with the replicas of the packaging.
Yeah.
But instead of having, you know, Gene, Ace Paul, it's got Demon, Star Child.
Yeah, so that's kind of cool. It's a good touch to it.
Yeah.
Again, also though, like lyrically, Pull the Trigger, My Love Gun. It's just the most Steel Panther lyric before Steel Panther were a thing.
Yeah. That's why I preferred back in the day when you had to use the innuendo. You couldn't just come out and say, come on, get it. It was more his love gun. Like, you know, what's his love gun? I thought that was brilliant. But, and Paul Stanley saying that this, he believes this is the quintessential Kiss song.
This is my favorite Kiss song.
Right, yeah.
Number one.
That's great.
It's the best. His vocals in it are amazing.
And that if you listen closely to Gene's bass line too, he's so underrated as a bassist that he's just pumping that thing out there. It's so melodic and just moves.
That stack of, like musically speaking, that stack of like vocals there in the chorus, it's like a choir just like yelling at you.
And then when you think about what they're singing, Love Gun.
Yeah.
It's just brilliant.
His dick.
And of course,
what they're singing.
And of course, we've got our Ace's vocal debut on this.
Yes,
with Shock Me.
Good song.
Which I thought was great. That turned me into an Ace mark.
And it gets you have Love Gun, which is that more like that quintessential Kiss sound.
Yeah.
But this goes back to the more meat potatoes, 8-bar rock and roll kind of vibe.
And I think this set up the whole Ace thing too, of keeping in with the Spaceman theme.
Yeah,
it's just great. What a great song for him to come out with for a vocal debut.
Absolutely. Good stuff.
And I always liked his voice too. Some people are indifferent to it, but I think I liked it more when it was one track or a couple tracks. Like, whereas these days, and I'm saying this on the verge of going to an Ace Frehley concert, having Ace sing the whole album, I sort of get a bit,
So, and then
I don't mind his vocals. I can take Ace over Gene more.
Yeah.
I'm not the biggest Gene vocal.
But I think if the song suited to Ace, that's why I think this is perfect.
Absolutely.
Because this is, you know, it's got that swagger.
Well, I feel like it's really funny how
he's
like,
not going to do the Ness and Dorma, let's put it that way.
Well, as you said, like, Wadsworth, I feel like they essentially had three lead vocalists at one stage. And it's really funny, like, a couple of minutes ago, we did play Rock and Roll or Not. Everyone's like, oh yeah, Paul Stanley's a front man of Kiss. But that's a Gene Simmons song.
Yeah.
Like, Gene sings that one.
Yeah.
That's a Gene song. So, same.
That's one thing that was interesting when I was little. Before I'd seen any clip or anything, I always thought, and this is really weird to think about it now, that Paul's vocal was Gene. Gene was the singer.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, to think back at that now, but then when I worked out, oh, hang on, no, that there's two of them singing.
Yeah, it was, well, there's a, I was listening to a band, like an internet band I listened to, and they just released a cover of Africa by Toto, and the singer was like, he was like, I honestly didn't know until we recorded this song, that was two guys, like they one sings a chorus, one sings the verses.
Okay,
like,
I don't think I knew that.
No, I actually didn't know either.
Well, Toto had three singers. Oh. They had two lead singers. And like, well, the thing is, like, one of them sings, names completely escape me. One of them sings the verse.
Yeah.
And the guy with the high register just sings the iconic.
Yeah, it was even some of those Queen chorus songs where Brian May sing like the bridge that I didn't get until I saw the film clip. And I'm like, oh, of course.
And then
like,
Roger Tallis sings those good super high harmonies, which are amazing.
Supersonic harmonies.
Well, that's so good. Unique to Kiss. Like, we should mention as well that, Peter Criss would do lead vocals on songs too. Yeah. It's rare for a whole band to do multiple songs. It wasn't just like, a one-off thing. Well, they would do it often.
I guess like modern-day versions, like bands like Mastodon, who have
You're right. Yeah,
they
four do
lead
too.
Singers too. Yeah. So,
and if we're talking Peter Criss, I think vocally for him, you know, I know there's Beth, but also Black Diamond.
Oh, of course,
Like, I think that's one of the best
and Peter
rock
seemed
vocal
to,
tracks.
Yeah, and he seemed to have the most rock and roll sounding voice. Yeah, I just had a whiskey and a packet of cigarettes, and now I'm ready to lay down some vocals.
Like, I love the live versions of Black Diamond because the vocals do get a bit rough, and they're sort of like, they're not the best, but that makes it. You know?
Even when Eric Carr would take over doing the Black Diamond vocal live, like, he was just phenomenal on that. That was just that was bombastic.
Loving it. So then between 1977, they released Kiss Alive 2, which I guess is one of their...
Oh, we've got the studio tracks on that on the fourth side, which I think, again, Ace didn't play on much of.
Yeah.
I mean, there's Rocket Ride on that. I remember hearing Rocket Ride on the... when it got to the solo and thinking, wow, he really is from outer space. Just with that flange on it and, it's just awesome.
Again, back to that old school, just like shuffle rock and roll kind of vibe, but it has that, as you said, brings their own guitar effects into it.
And to bring it back to wrestling, I think our friend Rick Derringer did some of the guitar work here of Real American.
Interesting.
Really? Yeah. Okay.
I think it was this. I know there's going to be Kiss fans shouting, it was this one, idiot.
There you go.
It was around this time and Bob Kulick was in on some of the... I love that story of... Bob getting called in to do some of Ace's tracks because he was in no condition to perform. Bob said as he was leaving the studio, Ace was sprawled out on a couch and said to Bob, how did I sound? And Bob said, best you've ever played.
Well, again, if we take it back to the film, some of the stuff, like the scenes that Ace are in, he's like holding on to stuff to like try not to fall over.
I don't think they were cut out for long days on set where it's, 14 hours of waiting around to do a, 10-minute take.
Yeah. I think it was on, Jericho did a thing on the film and they did, a watch through. He's like, I talked to Paul about it. He's like, yeah. And, Paul was like, yeah, if you call line, you say your line. If it's a good take, it's finished. And they move on to the next scene. I'm like, and you
can
tell.
It didn't even have to be a good take. It just had to be a take.
Exactly. And then you look at it. It's like you can tell that they've dubbed a lot of the voices because they were just like, A, couldn't understand them, or B, like in Ace's case, just couldn't speak English.
And it wasn't Peter's voice in it at all.
Yeah.
He didn't turn up for to do the dialogue recording.
I could go on about for ages, but then there's a part in one of the battle scenes where Paul Stanley's stunt double is a jacked black guy.
Ace's stunt double, and Paul's got the jacked one. It's so obviously not them in most of those scenes, which I thought was great. They did that also in our epic movie, I remember, and as the fight was going on, you're kind of going, this is obviously not the actor who portrayed it. No. Then you just got clear shots of his face that it was someone 20 years younger, some so ripped good. Asian guy who was the stunt double.
It's brilliant. In 1978, as we briefly touched on before, all four members released the four solo albums, all on the same day, September 18th, 1978. They released all the same day, same time.
Which in hindsight, a great idea until... these kids go to mum and dad, the new Kiss record's out, can you buy it for me? Oh, by the way, there's four of them. That's, I think, the biggest reason why that sort of tanked. They say, they shipped platinum. That means a million of them went into the stores. That doesn't mean a million of them sold.
Got sold, yeah.
So there's a warehouse somewhere that was getting all these shipped back because, having to buy four records all of a sudden, I think was really pushing the friendship.
Now, which one of yours is your favorite of Ace. The Aces?
I was Ace, Jane, then Paul, then Peter's. I think I listened to once and was like, ugh. Like, not that it wasn't well made, or it just wasn't my, you know, I thought it was a bit too Happy Days, or, which I don't mind that music, but yep. It wasn't what I was expecting.
Yeah, I feel like, yeah, listening to them, you go, like, Aces is definitely the strongest, and it shows that he was definitely the songwriter out of a lot of them.
Yeah, I just think, again, it suited his character, as I thought Gene's did too, even when he does, you know, closes with When You Wish Upon a Star. I like when they do that weird stuff, you know, like going back to Alice Cooper, you know, Welcome to My Nightmare, but then every album, Alice always busts out these beautiful, tender love ballads that I think also
like
fits
only
in
Only Women Bleed and stuff like that, yeah.
And all that still fits in with the character, because we're getting the emotional side here, a sensitive version to this monster. Gives it another dimension.
Which of the albums sold the best?
I think it was Aces as far as having the hit with New York Groove. But then I think Gene sold more here. I don't know. I think that's one of those, depending on where you are as to what sold more. But I think Aces is definitely the most popular with Kiss fans, which made him go, hang on, maybe I'm the Michael of this Jackson 5. Yeah.
I do like the Paul Stanley song, Tonight You Belong to Me.
Oh, yeah.
That is a good song.
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think Paul's was a winner in that it was the most Kiss sounding. He didn't go too far off the script. But I still don't know about that Hold Me, Touch Me, the Barry Manilow feel on that. I remember, I really think, you know, they did that compilation, Best of the Solo Albums. I really think that was the best of the solo albums. Cause I like that more than all of them. I just think, three of the best songs from each. Even the three Peter Criss ones on that, I think, great. Like, I Can't Stop the Rain. I thought that was awesome.
Yeah.
And, I think they were that best of the solo albums. I'd take that any day.
Over any of them.
Than the whole package, yeah.
Well, yeah, Ace's album went to number 30 in the Japanese album charts, 26 on the US billboards, and New York Groove went to number 13 on the US Hot 100.
Oh, okay.
And number 24 in New Zealand for all our friends across the ditch.
I feel like there's been a big resurgence of New York Groove in the last few years. Did they recently use it on a movie?
They may have.
Because I remember they used it in Entourage once, and it's just one of those songs that it seems to pop up. Great vocal. Never liked the live version of this for some reason. Okay. I don't like when they do it live. I don't think it lends itself, again, because of the production, I don't think it lends itself as well to the live version.
There you go. Again, and then after they released these solo albums, a year later they got back together and released Dynasty. And this was, I guess, when they went to the disco rock kind of vibe. And arguably their biggest song was released.
Yeah. What was the backlash like? I know a lot of people, you know, didn't like that they went too disco.
Yeah.
But then the kids are eating it up. You know, all of a sudden you've got the 10-year-olds buying this, which, you know, is good until the next album comes out and they're on to the next thing. So it's a double-edged sword.
I feel like this is the song that literally everyone knows. But again, as Jules said, it shows Gene's chops as a bass player, because he's just rumbling through that bass.
I don't think Gene played on it.
Really?
Yeah, I don't think any of them played on this particular track except for Paul.
Well, there goes my talking up of Gene Simmons.
Yeah, I think by this point on Ace's tracks, he was doing all the guitars and bass.
Okay.
So I think there was pretty fragmented by this point, because Peter doesn't play drums on the album at all.
That's
crazy. I
think on
Dirty Living, he does. They had Anton Figg from David Letterman's band.
Well, it says the opposite. Drums except Anton Figg on Dirty Living.
Yeah.
There you go. Still, huge song.
Yeah, this is the sound of a band falling apart.
It really was, weren't they?
What a last-ditch effort, though, because, you know, you get this massive hit out of it.
Mm. And then two tracks later, they have one of their bigger, well-known songs.
Mm.
But going,
imagine this at Studio 54 back in the day.
Just grooving around, as Hawko says the other week, getting down with your best girl. Just,
this is a funky song.
It's a good song.
It is good.
I feel like it shows Paul's vocal range a little bit better than most more of his other songs.
Yeah, he was definitely, I think, here starting to really hit his stride as a premier vocalist that when we get to the 80s stuff that I think he just took into the stratosphere.
We were talking about that before you got here. But yeah, because like the verse is like nice and soothing.
Mm.
And then right now when it kicks into the to the chorus, he's like just rips it.
He means business. Mm.
Big Paul. I'm a big Paul Stanley, Mark.
Yeah. I think, again, on this album, Ace saves the day with the rock and roll tracks.
Yeah.
He just more sort of kept it rock with... and, of course, it's got the... Rolling Stones cover, 2000.
Yeah, 2000 Man. Yeah.
Which is great. And Save Your Love.
And then, yeah, I guess moving forward, we've got, yeah, after this, in 1980, they released Unmasked, was released. Touring Cycle was the first to feature Eric Carr on drums.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's now the permanent member of the band. The album was a bit of a flop critically and commercially, despite having songs co-written by Vinnie Poncia, the former songwriter of Ringo Starr and the Beatles.
And he also produced Dynasty, the album. So this is where we're seeing them go back to who they did the previous album with.
Yeah.
And Anton Figg on drums again.
Yep.
So Peter Criss was pretty much effectively gone. Out of the band by here.
Absolutely out of here.
So this was one of my favourite albums. I love this. I know a lot of people don't like the production sound and the pop thing, but
yep.
I think it's a great album. For what it is in the time.
And again, they've got like the front cover as them, all four faces stacked up, this time in colour.
Yeah.
Peter Criss's green eyes glowing.
Yeah, iconic.
But yeah, Unmasked features, I feel like the one song that people may know is Shandy off of Unmasked.
Yeah, that was a big hit here.
Well, that's the thing. I think I wrote it in the notes. It was around this time where they kind of started dropping off in the States, but here in Australia and New Zealand, they were massive. Yeah,
that hit big here.
Absolutely huge in Australia and New Zealand. So it was because of these albums.
And great cover for Unmasked as well with the
comic book.
Comic book, yeah, and the colours and the artwork. That
yeah,
was all brilliant.
Very cool. I dig it. It just blows my mind how like you look at bands these days that they usually do like the two and two cycle. They go they'll release album in 2016. Two of that, 2018, they released an album.
Yep.
Kiss released an album literally every year
until
like the late 80s, which is insane to think about it. They're in 81, they released Music from the Elder, which was one of their biggest flops as an album.
This is where this is the dark times.
Yeah, people do not talk about this album. They actually never toured it.
I didn't even know the album existed. So I was like going through it for this episode. I'm like, never even heard.
Yeah, it was their worst performing album critically and commercially. That they didn't even tour it. They didn't bother to take it on the road.
When I was saying to you earlier, when I'd buy the Kiss records from that secondhand record shop and just being going on the covers of what looked cool, I remember always staying away from the older one as well. Just went, it's like brown and this doesn't look like fun.
Yes.
There's not even a picture of them, even in the gatefold, there was nothing.
Yeah.
So it's just their hand on like a big door knocker.
Yeah.
It is. It literally knocker. Is. In 1982, Ace Frehley departs the band, Vinnie Vincent joins, and Creatures of the Night was released.
We've got Ace on the cover there of an album he doesn't play on. And then they re-released Creatures of the Night a few years later with Bruce Kulick on the cover with no makeup. So two albums, two different album covers of the same album.
But three guitarists?
Featuring a guitarist on each that doesn't play on it.
So weird.
Yeah. And this one I loved and a great cover. And that, of course, you've got to address the huge Eric Carr drum sound.
I said this to Simon before, like, again, 1982, like, look, I'll be honest, and we're just about to get into that era of Kiss anyway. For years, I was like, nah, I fucking don't like, like, the unmarked, like, the paintless era of Kiss, unmasked era, Kiss is average. And then I start listening, like, I go back, like I say I go back, but then I listen to bands like Warrant and Twisted Sister and Wasp and that, and then you listen to, like, this era, it's like, fuck, it's the same like stuff.
Yeah.
Like I don't know why I didn't like it to start with. And now it's overtaken my love for Painted Kiss.
I was like that too. Because I grew up, you know, like a Kiss fan from my aunties and like older relatives. And to me it was always about like, you know, Kiss with their makeup, because that's what they told me was the good stuff, so I'd only listen to that.
Yeah.
And I was the same, like even when I started in radio, we would never play the 80s Kiss stuff because I was like, no, that stuff's not good. But really, after listening to it, to me, that's my favourite Kiss as well.
So I was the opposite. When I got into, like, hardcore, got into Kiss in, like, 87 with Crazy Nights.
Yeah.
Because they were selling that whole pitch then of, oh, we'll never put the makeup on again. We'll never get back together with A to P. Yep. And I marked out for that, thinking, oh, well, this is what it is now. They were the band that used to wear makeup.
Yeah.
They suckered me in. I didn't know they were just pulling, you know, dangling the cherry higher so you wanted more.
But we mentioned the album cover. This was the last album cover until 1997 to feature a painted Kiss.
Yeah.
With them all up in their painted glory. And that was the 98 with the god awful Psycho Circus album, which I guess we'll touch on once we talk about WCW.
Yeah.
And then so it was around this time Kiss were insanely, as I said, insanely popular in Australia, but the supported kind of declined in America and North America.
And of course, now at this point, they're competing with like Judas Priest and Iron Maiden and all this new metal that's coming out.
And then, with the advent of MTV, heavy metal is almost getting mainstream for the first time.
Yeah, because of all those bands, three or four years later, in like 85, 86, it was mainstream.
Bon Jovi, Motley Crue,
and Kiss are trying to shake this thing of being a kiddie band from a few years earlier.
And I guess around the same time, Def Leppard.
That's true.
They were starting to really get big in 83. So, I don't know, man.
Kiss had to do something.
Exactly. Yeah. I think Def Leppard would have released that album with like Photograph on it around this time, would have been around then. So they were starting to get big. Again, but then 83, Lick It Up was released, which is probably my favourite Kiss album.
No makeup. They're just on the cover as themselves. There's that great footage too. Like, I remember seeing it on, like, I don't know, Behind the Music or one of those things, where it's the press conference where, you know, they finally take off their makeup.
Yeah.
And it shows them with makeup and then without. It's just so funny.
It's so dramatic.
Like, what did people think when they first saw him? Because it's like... exactly. Just these, like, really normal-looking guys with this big hair.
And, like, I feel like we can all agree that, like... mid-80s Paul Stanley is a sexy motherfucker.
Yeah, well, I think, like, he was the one who was looking forward to getting it off the most. And then without the heels and the platforms, he danced up a storm in the 80s.
Those music videos with his dance moves are amazing. Yeah.
He was like an aerobics instructor.
He really was.
Should have worn a unitard instead.
Yeah. I'm sure he did.
And saying it's Paul Stanley with no makeup, it's Paul Stanley with less makeup. Yeah, he's still got some on, you know.
As Jules said, like... the two albums previous was where, like, Dynasty was where you really saw Paul bringing out this massive vocal range. Mm. This song especially, it's that really operatic, more like 80s glam style of singing, which I'm a big fan of, obviously. So yeah,
he really took it up a notch here.
Yeah, this album, so good. Lick It Up was pretty big. Like, it was like super awesome chorus, especially this song here. But, like, I've been listening to this album for the past few days, and like, there's some great tracks on it. Like,
and no guitar solo in the title track in Lick It Up, which I always thought was a weird choice, but fits.
Yeah, it's a good pop song,
yeah.
Lick It Up. And All Hell's Breaking Loose is like the other big single. Oh, it's a good song too.
I like that. Lick It Up. Paul's rap in it.
He did a few weird things.
Then there's songs like Fits Like a Glove is a cool song as well.
I love Fits Like
a Glove. It's so cheesy, but it's such a great song.
Going through her like a hot knife through butter.
Yeah.
Can't top that.
Terrible lyrics, but I'm more than okay with them. And then I guess again, 1 year later, they released another one of their huge albums, which was Animalize.
We've got to understand here too, when we're talking about album after album, this is before, you know, video games and DVD, so kids didn't really have much else to spend their money on.
Yeah.
So they couldn't buy movies to watch. It was really just records and comic books back then.
Yeah.
So the demand was there to fill. Now, of course, as we get into the 80s, we're seeing it slow down a bit more.
And again, 1984, this is the era where MTV started, so Kiss releasing some of the most glorious music videos, especially with this one.
Oh, man. The shot of Paul Stanley with his hands on fire at the start of this clip. One of my favorite videos.
And is this
videos.
The one, or am I getting it mixed up with Tears Are Falling, where he jumps through the ring of fire?
This is the one. This is the one with the crazy amazing pants.
Yeah. Yeah, like all the big... and frayed bits on
Gene's hair just has a life of its own in some of those.
Gene always has like the one face in all of these 80s videos. He looks really creepy. Like, he's got, like,
or like
creepy
someone's
look.
Just farted.
Yeah, yeah. Whereas
and probably him.
Paul's super animated dancing and Gene's like, I still look scary. And it's like, you don't, mate. No. Not anymore.
It's the Bea Arthur look.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this was the first album with Bruce Kulick on it. I say first, but he played on previous ones prior.
Yeah.
But first one where he was credited on it.
Mark St. John's actually pictured on the back with no legs.
Yes.
Because I think there's the Photoshop thing where they've just put half his body above the band. And where are his legs? He's just levitating there.
The other really, really good song on this that maybe some people look over, Thrills in the Night.
Oh, I love that song.
Man.
And there was that a film clip done for that was never released. I'd love to see it. I heard it was pretty hokey. So
The only thing that's close to a video for this that I found, it's like a live version.
Yeah.
But it feels like one of those live music videos.
Yeah, I think they chopped that up off that, because around this time they had that Animalize Live Uncensored, and it aired on MTV. So I think they'd filmed some stuff from that during the day.
And just called it a video, basically.
Yeah.
His vocals, Paul Stanley sounds really good on this song too. Again, this is where he like takes it up a notch.
Again, it's starting to follow the very like 80s, like the glam metal of huge intro, very like stripped back verse, and the chorus is massive. Yeah.
That's almost a Scorpions thing too.
Huge
starting
Scorpions.
With guitar like that, going into a verse like that.
And I've always noticed how in this chorus, it's really weird and works well that Eric Carr doesn't hit the snare drum. He's like on the floor toms or whatever, but even in the...
it's all floor toms, isn't it? That's so weird.
So good, though. To me, Kiss outglammed
everyone.
They've
just mixed it down.
It just sounds so good. Yeah. To me, it was like a lot of those bands would have been influenced by Kiss, a lot of the 80s bands, and it almost felt like Kiss reclaiming that from them.
Or the dog chasing its own tail.
Yeah, all that. But like they pull it off. Yeah. Like the videos are more over the top than anyone else.
Yeah, and Paul's producing here. He's taken over the production role. I think Gene had checked out. And Mark St. John saying he had to... Paul and Gene would be doing their stuff in separate studios, and he'd do a 12-hour day with Paul, and then Gene would call up and say, now I need you over here, which, I don't know, led to his, he had arthritic problems and things like that after the recording of this album. I think he was like, one album's enough, and they broke him.
Yeah, and then I guess after that we get to Asylum, which is, I'm not going to lie, it's an album I haven't really dove into, but I've listened to a couple of times, and it's just... I guess it's an album.
Tears Are Falling.
Yeah.
Another good song. Yeah. Great video as well. I think that's the one where, like, the women are dancing in the showers. Is it that one?
That's Who Wants to Be
Lonely. Who Wants to Be Lonely. So that one's good.
Although I love
Tears Are Falling.
I love the album cover. They all got the different lipstick shades on.
It's the 80s version of, like, their older covers. Like, all faces, but it's that
and
80s art style.
And the colour matches up to the corresponding solo album's cover. Paul's got the purple, Gene's got red, the drummer's got green, the guitarist's got blue.
Kiss Easter egg, that's a good one.
There you go. See, again, that's why we have the great man on the show.
To talk about the colour of their lipstick. I love on this, that a lot of people don't like All Night.
I was going to say, the album ends with
people
a great song.
People shit on that song, night. But I've always thought it was like the quintessential 80s crass. I just love it. And a great clip too. This is one with the nurses pushing the hospital beds in unison.
Oh man, nothing will beat the 80s era of like metal music videos, because they were just so ridiculous.
It was decadent.
That's what it feels like. Yeah. Kiss outdid those bands. Like, even dumbed down compared to what other people are, All Night. Like, it's so dumb, but it's so good.
So good.
And then, it's slightly tongue-in-cheek, because what was that weird Kiss doco that came out at the time?
Like Kiss Exposed. Yeah.
You watch that, and you're like, well, this is still a show. They might not be in makeup spitting fire anymore, but, like, this is a new persona. It's like this weird decadent 80s
thing.
Yeah.
So in that context, for me, that's how I, justify it.
It all fits. Yeah. Then, like a glove.
Oh, man.
Then, 2 years later, we get Crazy Nights. Awesome album cover. It's like the glass shattered, like the mirror shattering, and like the different, like... couple like different cut like photos of each member on the front cover.
This is the album that got me back in.
Really?
Okay. Yeah. So I had the aware of Kiss when I was younger, but for years I thought they were gone as well.
Okay.
And I remember so clearly watching Different Strokes in the afternoon, and an ad came on for the Crazy Nights album, and
really?
I was like, oh, Kiss, I remember them, and like the sound of the song, got it for Christmas that year, and I was in.
Although I must say, they they must have been really like struggling for names of songs, because it was Crazy Crazy Nights, Bang Bang You, No No No,
Thief in the Night.
Yeah, there's Thief in the Night, and there's Turn on the Night. So their vocabulary wasn't their strongest point.
A lot of nighttime activity going on at this point. And then again, Paul on the back cover showing the bit of blue G-string.
Yeah.
Was still haunts me.
Again, huge choruses. I feel like the thing with Kiss, like I think we touched on it earlier, they write memorable verses where like the lyrics or like the hook is good, but then that the chorus is just like, this is the part of the song you will remember forever.
I don't love this song though. I don't know, they still sort of play it live.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
Then the production's very thin on this album. I think this was one of those that was mixed and recorded for radio.
Yeah.
They wanted to, it was made to hear out of car speakers.
Yeah. And then I guess moving on 2 years later, if we're going to talk about production, this album's got a pretty good production. Hot in the Shade.
Mm.
The most ridiculous album cover ever, but I love it. It's the Sphinx with the sunglasses on.
Yep. Yeah, it looks like a postcard. Yep. But yeah, the Sphinx has sunnies on.
I think probably one of Kiss's longest albums, and they're like 15 tracks.
15 tracks.
I think if they
ticks over an hour.
Yeah, this could have been half. This could have been a great album if it was chopped in half. I think there was a lot of filler on this, and they just ended up going with a lot of the demos. I don't even think they're real drums on a lot of it.
Yeah, all of the drums in this song. Very cool.
Shotgun snarey.
This is their biggest song. This was their biggest song. It still is their biggest song since Beth. It went to number one everywhere.
Yeah. I think at the time we had Countdown Revolution on here in the afternoon and seeing the film clip and being like, oh, wow.
The film clip where it's like they're black and white, but the room is colour.
Yeah, there's like the yellow light spilling
room.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very sepia. Yeah.
Co-written by my favourite man in the world, Michael Bolton.
Yeah. And I had Hide Your Heart on this, which is great too.
Really good song.
Which around the time, I think it might have been a year or so later, an Aces album came out and also had it on there. And I was like, it's a Trouble Walking album.
I guess they kind of went for that. We're still a rock band. We're going to go again with like Forever. We'll go for like the big ballads that you can play at your wedding. But then you got stuff
like
this.
What was getting the radio play then. And,
yeah.
You know, all the I Remember You and...
Yeah, absolutely. Well, yeah, 89 was, I Remember Power You.
Ballads. Yeah.
Fucking Warrant would have been out with a couple of their big ballads as well.
I Saw Red.
Oh, what a tune. That tune makes me cry. It's so sad.
Poor Janie.
As if you'd sleep with your best friend. Anyway, that's a new story.
As if he'd cheat on Janie.
I know.
He did the cheating in that relationship. You didn't cheat on him.
Exactly. And I guess, and then we kind of... get into dark waters with Kiss.
Well, I think if I can hold you up there for one sec, we've skipped the greatest hits package, which was Smashers, Thrashers and Hits.
Okay.
Which had, if you want to talk great song titles, Let's Put the X in Sex.
Yes.
As Paul Stanley said, it was about his favourite subject, spelling.
That's a great, X in Sex is good.
And that also had the other new track called You Make Me Rock Hard.
Oh, You Make Me Rock Hard, one of their best videos.
Yeah,
Paul Stanley circus. Is like swinging on
the... He loves those circus stuff.
He was showing his athleticism in the 80s,
and he had a chainmail, like Scott Steiner, Big Papa Pump top on, with white tights. Yeah, this is it. And this also had Beth, but with the Eric Carr vocal on it, which was very controversial at the time. Fans were outraged.
God, what a great chorus this. Yeah,
and again, like they're the kings of the chorus.
Because it's You Make Me Rock Hard, like obviously giving him a hard on, but it's also like, no, you make me like dance, I'm rocking hard. It's like, oh, you know, he's very clever.
The brilliance of peace stand.
Innuendo or in your endo.
He's doing it all. And there's a great shot in this, like he's dancing and in slow motion, one of the girls comes past and he like gives her like a dip. He like dips her and then just pushes her to the side and keeps dancing on his own. It's so good. Yeah.
Amazing.
I was up till like 1:30 at night. Like I just went in a rabbit hole of watching all the 80s clips. And
I like that the dip stuck with you.
It's a, like slow motion dip. It was just so he could show that he could do that. And he's like, well, I'm going to dance.
Yeah, now get out of my shot.
Watch me do a cool kick.
Yeah.
Like,
Yeah, and then after this, I guess we go to Revenge, yeah. And then Alive 3 comes out.
Now, Revenge is a big comeback one, too. Yeah. And, of course, the controversial, again, of having a blonde drummer in the band after the passing of Eric Carr,
yeah,
and getting Eric Singer in. So I remember that being a big thing at the time, thinking, who are they going to get to play drums? And I remember hearing the name, like, Dean Castronova was thrown around,
yep,
for a while. And
God gave rock and roll to you. Two, which is the original
from the Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey soundtrack. I bought that and got this off that first, and
look,
thought it was a good
this
song.
This is a good song if it was 2 minutes shorter.
You reckon?
5.5 minutes with like a 2 minute outro.
Give it that epic feel.
Yeah, it's got epic. There's the single, I think, is edited down, yeah, a bit. It gets into it cuts off a lot of the front end and the back, yeah, end.
To me, as a kid, I think I can trace it. This is the first Kiss song I heard,
right,
from watching Bill and Ted.
Yep. Intro, so
that would have been like
intro
five
solo
something.
Though,
is good. It's a, yeah, sick song.
And then really, the film clip at the time, having the flashbacks of the classic Kiss in makeup.
Yeah.
I was thinking,
oh, big,
what's going on here?
Big,
the big
hangar, yeah,
playing electric guitars in puddles of water, splashing, yeah, around.
As you do, looking after your gear.
And Gene had that white warlock face with, yeah, the blood splattered across it.
And just reading, so the version in Bill and Ted has a 40-second guitar solo played by Steve Vai.
Yeah, I think that was
that
just part
different.
Of. I don't
for
think
the,
that
it's just in the movie.
Yeah, in the movie, yeah. It's not on the soundtrack because I think they were just having, you know, they were.
There you go. I did,
yeah,
not know
it wasn't
that.
Actually recorded as such.
But. And Steve Vai released just that solo on one of his albums.
Right,
he called it, okay, Final Solo. Yeah.
And then, yeah, then they do the MTV Unplugged in 96.
Yeah.
Which is pretty good.
It's not bad. It's a pretty good video.
They were matched with because they'd been doing all those conventions where they'd play for like 2 or 3 hours,
yeah,
doing Unplugged stuff.
Yeah.
So they were definitely ready to go with that.
And then they take sort of a hiatus after Revenge.
Surprisingly enough, though, Forever is not on that as an acoustic song. Mm. Anyway. Yeah, they do a bit of a. They bring out Carnival of Souls, which again is.
So a few years later.
2 years. I don't know.
Well, the reunion had kicked off after the Unplugged thing,
yeah,
and they got Ace and Peter, yeah, back in.
Yep.
And then. I think they only released Carnival of Souls because there were bootleg copies that, yeah, had been distributed.
Yep.
And now, they sort of went for something different on,
yeah,
Carnival,
yeah,
of Souls.
Yeah, which again was weird, chasing the current thing, going for the grunge thing, which it was already about 5 years,
yeah,
in.
Yeah, it was.
I think
INXS
suffered from the same thing. They tried making a
Motley Crue did the same thing.
I think everyone did. Yeah, a lot of
around the same time, Crue released, yeah, that grungier album,
yeah,
which a lot of
the
people.
John Corabi one.
Yeah, that, which, yeah, a lot of people think, oh, that's the best. That's,
nah,
the best,
really,
Motley Crue album.
It's,
nah, it's
they're,
not.
They're good albums, but not for that band. It's not what you're buying,
yeah,
that,
exactly,
music for. You know, yeah. And it was at this time too. All the bands were cutting their hair short.
Yeah, yeah.
And
you could Metallica
big change,
as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, when we did it, when we did that Motley Crue episode with Tamarch, he was like, I would have liked this more if it was released as a different band name.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true, because, yeah, yeah, it probably stands better on its own.
Exactly.
Don't tell us it's Crue or Kiss or Metallica, yeah, or whoever.
Then in 98, we get Psycho Circus, which is...
The title track isn't bad.
It's not bad.
Yeah, I never really took to it.
But it's not the best album. But I guess we're in 98, we're talking about Kiss, we have someone in wrestling, I guess we should talk about WCW.
Yeah.
We've talked about it on our WCW episode, but... We have a Kiss expert on. We should talk about it with a Kiss expert themselves. You were a WWF guy, were you?
Growing up, but by that point, I was all WCW.
Okay.
All my favorites were there.
Okay.
Hogan and Savage and all that.
Yeah. So what was your first reaction when they... So obviously, I know a little bit, but did they tease the Kiss demon, or was it just there? Did he just pop up when...
No, I think they knew... It was coming.
Yeah.
Like they'd piped it up. And I remember being excited for that episode and thinking, wow, Kiss playing on a wrestling show.
Yep.
And then just seeing it and just sort of being like, ugh. And I think a lot of it had to do with choosing God of Thunder as the song.
Yeah.
It wasn't really a get on your feet sort of thing. And it was mimed and just remember thinking it was lackluster. And I knew someone who went to that show.
Really?
And he just said, oh, yeah, the whole night was pretty boring.
Well,
and you're thinking they've got Hogan and Sting in the main event, and then Kiss are going to play, and people are saying it's boring. Yeah. And I think also at this point too, the whole Kiss reunion thing was getting to the point of oversaturation.
Yes.
Like a year or two before, what year was this?
This was 98.
98, so the reunion kicked off in 96, I think. So we've already had 2 years of the original lineup, and I think the shine had definitely worn off by this point, including for the guys in the band.
Yep. And because they brought back the big, like the old, like, Gene's got the axe base.
Yeah, and they've got to go back to the destroyer costumes.
Yeah.
Which suits wrestling, though. Like, the especially Gene's outfit. The, like, it looks the fucking cool.
The thing is, like, as we've said before, these are wrestling characters. Yeah. Like, this should be a rest. Like, and the fact that they were going to build a faction out of it is, like how they're going to do. I've even read somewhere that they were going to do have four guys and four girls. Yeah. And they were going to this big faction of Kiss, and it just didn't really.
Eric Bischoff spoke about this on his podcast a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah.
So it sort of cleared up some of the things we heard and that we spoke about when we covered this a few months ago.
Yeah.
In that it was a payoff for just the performance. It was almost like it was meant to be an ongoing deal.
Yes.
Mainly for merchandising, because obviously, you know, Kiss had that, whereas WCW didn't. It could build to that. So, you know, in theory, it sounded like a good idea.
Yeah, and Vince would have done it differently. Vince would have made it work.
Well,
I even think if they maybe opened the show with Kiss doing a song and then did this later and revealed the demon, it could have been, but I don't know. I just remember watching the show with my bandmates at the time.
Were you underwhelmed?
We just sort of watched and went, ugh.
Okay. Yeah. But the thing is, they got paid $500,000 for this performance.
But that was the payment for more things, though.
Of course.
That was all inclusive of the deal.
But still, that's insane when you think about it, too.
But in a way, also kind of a bargain if you think, okay, we get the rights to use the Kiss character and Kiss music ongoing. I guess.
And I guess Kiss are getting to be on it. You know, Nitro was still doing all right with the ratings, so they're getting into all these homes.
Yeah.
Yep.
On that. It would have seemed like a win-win for everyone, but...
But then... Like, no offense to the guy who had to play the Kiss demon.
Dale Torborg.
He wasn't into it, was it?
Yeah, he didn't really. Originally, it was meant to be...
Crush, wasn't it? Yeah, Crush, his name? Brian Adams.
Yep.
He wasn't into it. I think he did the reveal, didn't he?
He did. And then he was Torborg. The original one.
Right.
He comes out, and then Torborg is the... He actually did it until like...
And after a bit of time, they would then refer to, like, oh, Kiss Demon, Dale Torborg. And I always thought that took away from it, too.
Right,
like,
yeah.
I don't know who that is. Why are you telling me that name?
Well, it says here, Kiss were guaranteed their demon-themed wrestler would wrestle a main event match with the contract they made with WCW. This was supposed to happen at a special 1999 New Year's Eve pay-per-view against Vampiro. The pay-per-view and the match were taken off the table, however, after Eric Bischoff lost his position in September 1999, and in order to fulfill the contractual obligation, he was booked.
It's very tap how he can't get out of the cocoon. Sorry, I cut you off.
No, it's all good. And then they did a special main event match at a Super Bowl in early 2000, and that's when
it seems like Kiss may have got involved with the deal, not understanding the politics of wrestling. We'll put him in the main event, we're going to do this and we're going to put championships on him. Then you got someone else there going, that's not going to work for me, brother.
But it's kind of cool, like the idea. And again, in theory though, the idea of the New Year's Eve pay-per-view / Kiss concert, that sounds kind of cool.
Oh, if you had told me that when I was a kid, I would have been losing my mind.
Yeah, absolutely.
Again, with WCW at this point, it was just a lot of the execution with things sort of just fell a little short.
Yeah. And that ended the episode of Nitro. That ended it.
It was just weird. And it's okay, that's it.
It is strange. Well, I guess now after that, Kiss have done reunion after reunion and show up.
And become a solid touring band in terms of, like, that's their business. Well, they tour and merchandise.
Never seen them. Really? I've never got to see Kiss.
Well, it's a different ball game now with the Paul Stanley vocal issues, which will no doubt raise the ire of many fans who seem to think it's all right. But that's really killed it for me.
Yeah. So when was the first time you saw...
Kiss Live? Yeah. The first tour was that, would it have been 95 or whatever when they came down? So it was like the Revenge lineup, but they were promoting the Kiss My Ass tribute album.
Oh, okay.
And the first actual gig I saw was the day before they did a Unplugged thing at the Hilton.
Oh, wow.
So, they did Q&A and all that. And then the next two nights at Rod Laver.
Very cool.
So that was the first actual tour. So the first time I actually saw them play was, yeah, an Unplugged set.
And was that wasn't the reunion lineup? Was that
still? No, that was with Eric Singer and Bruce Kulick, so they hadn't put the makeup back on yet.
Oh.
So it was the first Aussie tour in like 15 years or something.
Oh, wow. And that's interesting if it was their first Aussie tour in 15 years, but they were massive all the way throughout the 80s too, especially in Australia.
But I think their record company out here just had the thing of, oh, no one wants to see them, or that political agenda. Like, I remember it would even be hard to find Kiss albums when they'd come out here. I'd go to Brash's or something and there'd be like one copy, or, it's not in yet, maybe next week. There'd be no posters or anything like that.
I feel like since the reunion, though, they've been here a few times.
Yeah,
like,
well, I think after they came and saw, hang on, we just sold out two nights at Rod Laver, and that was no makeup Kiss. Then I think on the reunion tour, they did three nights, and that's Australia's like, one of their biggest.
That's like 50,000 people over three nights.
Yeah. They've done Eddie Had a couple of times. They did it with the Symphony.
And they did it with, Motley Crue.
Motley Crue was half the stadium, which I didn't know until I got there. I was like,
oh. Yeah, they bought it right forward.
So even though Kiss might not be the best live anymore because of Paul Stanley, Kiss were way better than Motley Crue that night.
Though. Oh, yeah.
To me, Motley Crue were like the worst live band I've ever seen.
Yeah.
Or for a band of that scale.
Well, that's because because you have a giant human Cheeto at the front of the stage being Vince Neil.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what Vince Neil's excuse is, but he sounds terrible.
Oh, he still does.
He's just lazy.
A mate of mine was recently at Varken in overseas. He was like, I'll send you videos of Vince Neil. I'm like, no, don't.
The thing with like Paul Stanley's vocal issue, and these people say, oh, well, you try doing it when you're 60 or 70. Like, I get all that. But there's also the part that says, well, when you can't do that anymore, bow out gracefully.
Yeah.
And it's just because of his work ethic. You know, we're talking about some of those high vocals he was hitting in the 80s. And he never took time off. He was doing Kiss albums or tours, then he did solo tours, he did Phantom of the Opera, he did that Fogel's coffee commercial. You know, so he never took a break. Like, and now he's doing like Soul Station in between Kiss. So it's just really weird how it's almost like that he knows there's something going on, but rather than address it or rest, it's like, no, I'm just going to do more. But I'm in the minority because they are still selling out stadiums around the world. So
Well, I guess we've been going for quite some time, but it's been a very educational episode of the show.
We all learned something new here today.
We all did. Neither of you knew that Africa had two vocalists.
Yes. No, so I'm going to go and listen to it now.
Yeah.
But so I guess I guess we should just finish it off, maybe do with a round table. But Jules, what makes you still listen? Like, Kiss are your favorite band, obviously.
Mm.
Why? Like, just why after all these years, why are they still?
I think it comes down to the songs, you know, like the makeup and the show and all that's a bonus, but it's always been the songs for me.
Yep.
And like we're saying, just those good hooks, catchy choruses that stick in your head. Why I like bands like Slade and Twisted Sister, it's all that similar sort of thing. I sort of think of it as like a cartoon rock.
Yeah.
Easily digestible, the message is clear, and it's fun and it's positive.
Yeah. Simon?
For me, it's Paul Stanley. It comes down to him.
Yeah.
Like, I'm a front man guy. To me, it's, you know, for most bands, it's about, like, the vocals and all of that.
Yeah.
He's a great singer. The lyrics are always, you know, a lot of fun, especially the 80s era, you know, the music videos play a part. Yeah. But then it's just, like, the stage presence and the banter and all of that. Like, I think, you know, if you're going to be on stage, if you're going to be a rock star, like, go full tilt. And to me, Paul Stanley is, like, still the guy. Like, I think he's the best at it.
And they've kept it fun, too. When I was a kid, I used to love watching the Monkees show, stuff, you know, like that, where it's like, and the Archies. And the songs are great and they stand by themselves. But if you get more, that's a bonus.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I guess for me, I guess, as I said before, I'm a big Paul Stanley mark, like, just his singing was awesome. Again, his face paint's always like the one I liked most. Just like the one star. Everyone else was really elaborate. His was just like white face.
To cut you off again. You just reminded me of something funny I saw today that Paul Stanley posted that Chris Jericho sent him of Stan Lee, the Marvel guy.
Oh, yeah.
And it's got Paul Stanley.
Very good. I'll have to chase it up. But then coming from like the music side of when a couple of years ago I played bass in a band with some mates for their music exam, and they're like, yeah, we'll just play a heaps of Kiss songs. And I had to play bass for it. And I'm like, fuck, you don't realize how good they were as musicians, especially Gene, as we said previously. Like, motherfucker played bass like an absolute madman. Yep. And like, there's me just like learning all these Kiss songs and then appreciate them as a fan previously, but then as a musician going, oh, like these guys had amazing chops. Yeah. So it gives that little perspective. And then I guess the theatrical side as well was really cool too.
Very underrated as musicians. Absolutely. Especially those people, oh, they can't play or they can't. It's but you're someone who's too focused on the image.
Yep.
That's burnt into your brain too hard and you're judging that, you know, going by the appearance.
Exactly.
Yeah. And we'll wrap it up there. Go listen to Kiss.
Yes.
Especially All Night.
Yeah. We want you to All Night.
Yeah.
And of course, Julian, where can people find you online?
I'm at Twitter, Big Daddy Julian J. I think that's my thing. I'm out there, Facebook, Wrestle Rock. Track me down.
Well, I guess send
me your complaints, Kiss Army. I'll send something that's going to upset someone.
Now, you've got a big show coming up.
We do.
October the 6th at the Corner Hotel for Wrestle Rock, presenting Wrestle Brunch.
Yeah.
Of course, it's a liquid brunch.
And it is 500 metres from the MCG. Obviously, that night is the big Super Showdown WWE show.
And as they're saying already, if you can make it to the MCG, then you didn't wrestle rock hard enough. You make me wrestle rock hard all night.
There we go. But yes, Jules, thanks for coming back.
Thanks for having me again, guys. There was only one person
we had in mind for this show was you, because we've seen your collection of Kiss. I've talked to you about Kiss for ages. So you're the one guy we've wanted to have on the show, I guess, twice. We've had the Wrestle Rock chat. Now we've had the Kiss chat. So.
Yep.
Thank you, Jules, for coming back on.
Looking forward to doing it again sometime.
Ooh, we'll catch you next time.
When we rock you like a hurricane.